जारी
हाँ सर बेटा।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। दिस आफ्टरनून वी हैव एन इम्पोर्टेंट लेक्चर ऑन चैलेंजेस टू नेशनल सिक्योरिटी एंड द रोल एंड रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ द यूनियन एंड द स्टेट्स। द डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्पीकर दिस आफ्टरनून इज कॉमोडोर उदय भास्कर। He has been in the Navy for nearly four decades. Even though he shed his uniform nearly three decades ago to join the strategic analysis stream, his connectivity with the Indian Navy has remained full and intact. He superannuated in 2007 after 37 years of very distinguished service. I have had the great pleasure of knowing Commodore Bhaskar ever since he joined the strategic analysis arena. He had come to the Institute of Defense Strategic Analysis in the early 1990s. He served there for many years till he became the Director General of the IDSA. 2004-5. He has been the chief of a very eminent think tank, not only once, but several times over. He also headed the Navy's Maritime Foundation, and subsequently, till now, he's been heading the Society for Policy Studies. Commodore Bhaskar's essential areas of interest have related to nuclear studies, the nuclear issue, and to international strategic studies, naturally with a focus more on India, South Asia, Southeast Asia, and our neighborhood. He has had very close relations with the US Naval War College in terms of academic and research exchanges, with the Royal Navy Studies, Center for Royal Navy Studies, Strategic Studies, with our own National Defense College, and all our military training and colleges of war, training institutions and colleges of war. He is an author, he has edited several volumes, and he is a regular columnist in our mainstream newspapers. Besides his avid interest in military strategic affairs, Commodore Bhaskar is also a known art critic. He's interested in the performing arts, in theater, in films, and he writes regularly under a pseudonym to distinguish his personality from mainstream interests in military affairs, from what people may not like to fully understand, his interest in the realm of art and culture. Now, before I request Commodore Bhaskar to speak to us, I will very briefly mention that under our constitution, the states have been made responsible for the maintenance of police and public order, as against the Union, which is responsible for protecting the states as the whole entire territory of India against external aggression, that is war, and internal disturbance. Now fine, this seems good enough and simple enough. Translated into governance terms, this has created the mythology that the Ministry of Home Affairs and the states are responsible for internal security, and the Union Defense Ministry and the Cabinet are responsible for external security. Now, over the decades since we attained independence, we have seen for ourselves, and I would not make exhaustive listing, that the country has faced unending, virtually a series of serious internal security problems. May there be the militancies, insurgencies in the Northeast. May there be the extreme left-wing movement, the Naxalism. May there be the growth of terrorism in Punjab in the late 80s, which traveled to JNK in the early 90s, the beginning of 90s, when Pakistan commenced its proxy war against India. So the erstwhile or the original concept or the original perception that internal security is a marginal, minor matter left to the states, they have police and they are constitutionally responsible for public order, that is no longer a viable thesis. Internal security management over the decades have got intertwined with external threats, with the infiltration, with radicalization, with the organized crime, international mafia, and what our Western neighbor has been doing now, well, almost ever since it came into being, 70 years now, it's been instigating, manipulating, organizing varied forms of interference and subversion with the basic objective of creating a chaos which leads to the decline of the established order, particularly in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. While our neighbor has not so far been able to achieve any element of significant success, the fact remains that terrorism in its various forms has become a fact of life in our country. It's not only Bombay, it's not only attack on the Air Force station in Pathankot, it is multiple incidents in the state of JNK, which organized terrorist crimes. So therefore, come back to the constitutional framework and to raise the question, is it enough for the Union of India to leave things where they are with a very large problem facing the states and therefore for the country, with internal security issues having got deeply intermixed, intertwined with external security issues? It is now time for the Union of India to frame a comprehensive, well-considered national security policy, or a doctrine, if you like to use that word, which clearly delineates the varied form of threats which face our country. We have land and sea borders of nearly over 23,000 kilometers, vast open skies, almost 25 million square kilometers of EEZ, and threats from multiple sources. So the national security policy will not only have to at least broadly define the framework of our national security system, but to go further and to broadly lay down the responsibilities of the states and the union, which go far beyond the traditional concept of attributing only local law and order to the states. The nature of the coordination or cohesive collaboration between the states and the union will have to be far-reaching. It'll have to be in regard to the infrastructure for security management. It shall also relate to mobilizing and training the specialized manpower for security management, various intelligence agencies, counterintelligence agencies, dealing with cyber warfare as happens today, and varied other threats that the country is facing and has been facing for some time now. So we need a holistic pan-India policy framework, which is apolitical, which is bipartisan, and which brings together the states amongst themselves in a region, a neighborhood, and the states individually and collectively with the Union of India to share the enormous responsibility of safeguarding the unity and integrity of our country. And if we fail in any manner to have a national security framework and to implement it in letter and spirit, there will continue to be serious threats to the sovereignty and territorial integrity, the very unity and existence of our country. Now, with these few words, I will now request Commodore Bhaskar to please speak to us. Commodore Bhaskar.
Thank you, Vora sir. Good afternoon, everybody. And greetings. I gather that there are some people who have also tuned in from outside of India. I am very gratified to know of the response that my talk has elicited. At the outset, allow me to thank the India International Center and Mr. Vora, the president, for inviting me to share my thoughts on the subject of India's national security challenges, with a focus on center-state responsibilities. I think Mr. Vora has provided a very lucid backdrop, and I would in many ways be elaborating on some of the bullets that he has already identified. At a time when there is a surfeit of webinars and similar options, I want to acknowledge the presence of all those who have joined this afternoon and thank you for participating. I recognized some of the names before we started the show, and I wanted to add that many among you have a deeper water table than me when it comes to national security, because mine is a slightly modest perch, that of an analyst who is still studying the subject and making notes. The trigger for this talk is a series of conversations that one had at the center over the last 2 years with members regarding national security, both formally and informally. And the president, Mr. Vora, had convened a few meetings with domain experts and heads of think tanks. At that time, I had suggested that the membership of the IIC represents a very rich but untapped gene pool of expertise and experience, both at the center and the state in matters of national security. And many of our senior members have been practitioners and policymakers of rare pedigree. I'd like to draw attention to Mr. Vora himself, the president of the IIC, wherein he has had the unique distinction of serving both as the defense secretary and the home secretary at the center. He's also been the PS to the prime minister and the governor of Jammu and Kashmir at a very challenging phase in the recent past. There are many others who I wish to recognize from the IIC membership, but time does not permit me except to say that I have benefited from conversations with very senior members, like, for instance, Mr. Nirmal Mukherjee, a former cabinet secretary, and members of his generation, who were, I think, very generous in sharing their thoughts and writings in my early years at the IDSA when I was trying to study and understand national security. Now, to build on what Mr. Vora has already said, there has been a fair amount of churning with respect to national security in recent years, since Kargil of 1999, And some very useful reports, documents, and books are now available in the public domain. While these are useful in irrigating this very vital issue of national security, I'm afraid they have not resulted in the kind of institutional redress that is sorely required. And hence, from Kargil 1999, Mumbai 2008, to Galwan 2020, some very vital lessons remain to be learned at the institutional level and policy correctives applied. Hence, what I propose to share with you this evening will be relatively familiar to many of you, and the objective of my talk is more to stimulate a set of similar deliberations that will enable what I describe as a pooling of national security know-how and domain-specific expertise that can be shaped into policy-relevant inputs. And I believe that the IIC and its members could play a very valuable role in this endeavor. National security is both an old chestnut and a complex domain as far as public policy issues go, and has been reviewed and discussed periodically in different fora, including the India International Center. I recall roundtables that were held when Mr. John Lal and Mr. Uma Shankar Bajpai were at the helm. And in many ways, I would say that the complexity of the national security challenge has become more tangled and also more opaque. Now, the reason why I characterize the concept of national security as a complex domain is because of its DNA, national security across the world. It is inclusive, it is expansive, it is multi-tiered, and it is predicated on the political dispensation of the nation state that we are examining. Over the decades, the concept of national security has acquired an anomalous quality in that while it has certain constant elements that relate to both the entity of the state and the citizen, there are other issues that have to be brought on board. At the core, the sanctity of national sovereignty and the pursuit of human well-being are illustrated. Concurrently, national security acquires a dynamic quality wherein significant transmutations are taking place due to the impact of technology, and hence in the jargon, we refer to techno-strategic imbrication, that is the synergy between technology and strategy. In the 20th century, the shift from the horse to the tank, or the arrival of radar and sonar, are illustrative at one level, while the advent of the apocalyptic atomic age, as represented by Hiroshima and Nagasaki in August 1945, marked the emergence of WMD, or weapons of mass destruction, into the national security calculus. It is against this backdrop that I wish to dwell briefly on the first part of my talk, namely India's national security challenges. I'm cognizant of the grim reality that today's deliberation is taking place when India is grappling with the COVID pandemic, the second wave, which is an unprecedented public health crisis that has severely impacted human security in a stark and tragic manner. In relation to the challenges of national security that India is now facing, the first bullet, a familiar one, is to acknowledge that national security can no longer be prioritized in an exclusive manner, and much less in terms of hard security or the military dimension alone. The anomalous end of the Cold War testified to the tenet that national security in today's context is an inclusive concept. And one way to visualize it is in the form of a hexagon, where the primary strands are the political, economic, and military attributes, and complementing these are the technological, environmental, and human determinants. This distillate has also been referred to as comprehensive national capability or power. And finding the appropriate equipoise along all the six elements is a perennial challenge for the policymaker and the national leadership. The related second bullet, apropos this inclusive definition of national security, is that the state has to acquire both the capacity, the competence, and the resolve to anticipate to the extent possible and manage the challenge before it morphs into a threat and finally a crisis. To cite recent examples, both Galwan of 2020 and the current COVID surge are illustrative of how security exigencies can very quickly spiral out of control. This brings me to the next link in this lattice, namely that the pursuit of national security in the 21st century has to foreground the well-being of the citizen in an equitable and empathetic manner by those who have been entrusted with the mandate to govern. This is not new as a formulation, and many among you will recall the Arthashastra and Kautilya, wherein the emperor of ancient times was exhorted to ensure the yogakshema or the well-being of the citizen. The current COVID pandemic has highlighted the lack of appropriate capacity in relation to public health infrastructure, and any future review of resource allocation will have to factor in human security in a composite and appropriate manner. Thus, when it comes to the spectrum of national security, it is to envision it in a holistic and inclusive manner, beginning with the territorial integrity of the geography of India in its entirety, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, and from Andaman Nicobar to Lakshadweep Minicoy, and concurrently ensure that the human security, the well-being, the yogakshema of this vast demography of 1.3 plus billion is not compromised or transgressed inadvertently or deliberately. Now, this is a daunting task for those who have been entrusted with the pursuit and the protection or the distribution of this composite security, which is why one may aver that the national security responsibility, or Dayatva as it is called, is a 24/7 treadmill for those who have this mandate to provide national security. Let me turn now to the center state issue, the responsibilities that devolve on both these interlocutors in relation to national security. Mr. Vohra has already provided the backdrop about the manner in which this had been delineated in the Constitution. And I'll just add to that, which is that as pointed out by experts, under the provisions of the Indian Constitution, national security is not a subject that is specifically listed in any of the three lists. That is, we have the Union, the State, or the Concurrent List. Under Part 18, Articles 352 and 355 refer to external aggression and internal disturbance again. The President, Mr. Vohra, had referred to this, and the role of the Union government. Now, in a normative sense, it stands to reason that both the center and the state have a shared responsibility when it comes to national security and ought to be on the same page, particularly in relation to the external domain. The broad principle that obtains as far as governance and policy is concerned, is that security in a macro sense and that which is along the external contour of the country is the responsibility, the primary responsibility, which devolves on the Union government or the center in Delhi, and that law and order is a state subject. meaning chief ministers in individual states and lieutenant governors in the case of union territories, have the responsibility to maintain such law and order, which in turn has a direct bearing on the well-being of the citizen. Given its complex diversity and the nature of the Indian socio-political trajectory from August 1947, center-state political discord and dissonance is as old as the Republic. There are some very interesting documents now in the public domain that relate, for instance, to Kerala and the advent of the first communist government in Kerala at that time, when Pandit Nehru was the prime minister. And as I said, the political discord and dissonance that was reflected in the first decade. The imposition of precedence rule by the center in individual states for a perceived breakdown in law and order and other transgressions, more often than not, when the central government had a political identity that was at variance or in opposition to the political party that had the mandate to govern in the states. We have seen this pattern very often, and state governments have gone to the highest court, and in certain cases, in some very important cases, they have also been given redress. Now, all of this, precedence rule, breakdown in law and order, transgressions both by the center and the state, are part of the Indian historical narrative and have continued, as I have pointed out, from Prime Ministers Nehru to Modi. The need to review what was envisioned by the founding fathers against the actual unspooling of Indian politics led to the need to review the center-state relationship, and perhaps useful recommendations needed to be made in keeping with the fact that many decades had passed and the nature of the Indian security challenge, as also center-state, had undergone a certain radical change. And in many ways, the Mumbai experience of November 2008, 2611, acted as a trigger pulse, and we recall the way in which certain initiatives were undertaken, as for instance, the setting up of the NIA, the National Investigating Agency. This is when the UPA government at the time had constituted the Punchi Committee, the former Chief Justice, and the Punchi Report on center-state relations was submitted to the government in March 2010. It had many eminent members from different disciplines who had lots of experience, both in terms of national security, governance, constitutional provisions, and so on. And this is an exhaustive document. For those who wish to study the subject further, I would urge you to look at it in its entirety. It is in 7 volumes. It has 273 recommendations, and many of them touch upon some of the more sensitive aspects, both of national security, law and order, and the kind of responsibilities that devolve upon the center and the state, and what kind of new provisions needed to be made. This was 2010. However, in the last decade, there has not been any evidence to suggest that the more substantive recommendations to reduce center-state discord in matters relating to internal security and law and order have been internalized by both the interlocutors, that is, the center and the state. The aftermath of Mumbai 2008, the 2611 terror attack, as I had said earlier, and the acrimony over the NIA and other provisions in relation to terrorism and the need for intelligence gathering led to a lot of discord between the center and the state governments. And if you recall, leading the charge at the time to protect the rights of the state governments in relation to law and order was the Chief Minister of Gujarat, Mr. Narendra Modi, who is now the Prime Minister. From then to now, while the current political orientation in the country may not be conducive for a radical improvement in center-state amity due to the deep ideological divergences now that have surfaced between the BJP and some of its principal opponents, which we have seen in the electoral campaigns, two areas merit scrutiny by civil society for their long-term national security implications. The first relates to the external domain. Two incidents are illustrative. The imprudently conceived and executed IPKF effort in Sri Lanka, the Indian peacekeeping force, and the more recent Mizoram-Myanmar refugee issue are illustrative. Separated by almost 30 years, the Delhi-Chennai dissonance over the LTTE was a tragic case wherein the political contestation within Tamil Nadu was detrimental to the objectives being pursued by Delhi, and the net result was a tragic loss of lives at many levels, and I would add Indian credibility. The second incident, in March this year, the Mizoram Chief Minister, Mr. Zoram Thangma, conveyed his views on the Chin refugees from Myanmar and their affinity with the local tribes in Mizoram. We may recall that because of the civil war and the unrest in Myanmar, there was an influx of refugees, and both Delhi and Aizawl had different views on the subject. In public comments, the Chief Minister of Mizoram added, I quote here, "It may be mentioned that the Myanmar areas bordering Mizoram are inhabited by Chin communities who are ethnically our Mizo brethren, with whom we have been having close contacts throughout all these years, even before India became independent," unquote. The Aizawl-Delhi differences over the policies to be adopted in relation to the civil war in Myanmar resulted in a tense fortnight, with instructions from the state government being overruled by Delhi. The airing of such differences over a matter that has grave security and foreign policy implications in the public domain was avoidable. Differences would always exist in a democracy between the center and the state over a range of issues. But I would make the case that it was not very judicious to allow these differences to play out in front of the cameras, particularly in the 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. window, when India is in a frenzy almost on a daily basis. The second area of center-state discord is that relating to law and order and the manner in which electoral politics and a deep-seated inter-party power struggle has led to a very serious distortion of existing protocols and practices. Again, let me say that for those among you who would like to study this subject in greater detail, I would draw your attention to a lecture delivered by Mr. Vula in September 2020 at the Aligarh Muslim University. It's an exhaustive speech, a lecture of almost 9,000 words. And for any student of governance in India in relation to security, I would urge you to read that document, read that speech. But for now, for purposes of our deliberations this afternoon, I want to highlight and draw attention to two unsavory incidents which are indicative of what lies ahead as far as India is concerned in terms of the center-state relationship as far as law and order and internal security are concerned. The Mumbai Police Commissioner incident. Again, the details are familiar. I will not recount them in the interest of time. And the current CBI arrest of TMC members in Bengal, also the details are very familiar, have attracted adverse comment for the selective interpretation of the law and the manner in which central agencies have been tasked. Now, as an analyst, my reading is that unless there is effective and objective judicial intervention in such matters, the center-state discord on sensitive security-related issues, as also in matters pertaining to law and order, with a visible political overhang, will deteriorate in the years ahead. And this augurs poorly for the texture of India's composite national security. There is chapter and verse about the criminalization of politics in India and the politicization of criminal activity. And this, when it permeates the complex internal security fabric of the country with the external security linkages that Mr. Vora has already drawn attention to, the nature of the Indian security challenge is going to become even more tangled, complex, and more opaque. That is the reason why I used the word opaque, that there's very little sunlight about these transgressions and the way in which this particular virus, if I may, is permeating the security fabric of the country. Let me turn now to what states can perhaps do as part of their own contribution to the national security discourse. The first observation is that every state and union territory in India has its own security experience and a set of issues that it needs to prioritize. In other words, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, and Mizoram have different security challenges at this point in time, and hence their capabilities would have to be acquired and nurtured accordingly. Some effort has been made, but I would say that it is very modest and more needs to be done. For instance, in relation to the low intensity conflict, what is often referred to as the Maoist Naxal violence that India is dealing with in different parts, and what kind of capacities have been provided to individual states, and what is it that they need to acquire at state level. The Punchi report provides a useful starting point, and each state could consider embarking upon a review of its own security challenges and the harmonization from their perspective with the 2010 report. Again, my sense is that if we look at the different parts of India, I presume the coastal states and peninsular India would have a different kind of prioritization. The erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir and those who are dealing with the state-sponsored terrorism from across the border would have their own priorities. The Indian Northeast and what I just referred to about the regional issues, whether it's Myanmar or elsewhere, would have a different priority. And it's in this sense that I believe that the creation of a state perspective planning cell that would look at both the security and related foreign policy issues that are specific to each state could be considered with professionals drawn from local human resource, the state government. academia, think tanks which are located in the region, in the state, civil society with the requisite expertise could also be encouraged, as also private sector players who have a certain stake in the state in question. In other words, a state-specific security ecosystem should be allowed to grow slowly, and these recommendations could provide the substance for further review and allocation of resources in much the same way that the erstwhile Planning Commission and now the Niti Aayog have the responsibility to allocate resources to individual states for their economic development. I submit that the security agenda, the security wish list, if you will, for individual states must also be drawn up and deliberated upon, whether under the aegis of the interstate or any other forum that the Prime Minister and the Cabinet deem appropriate, should be considered with the highest urgency. Now, in the earlier part of my talk, I made a brief reference to technology and its impact on the prosperity and security of the state and the citizen. The 21st century will be one where the most intense contestations and animation is likely to take place in the maritime cyber space continuum. Artificial intelligence, robotics, spectrum dominance, and more will be the new tools of state power and the corporate technology giants. Now, how is this relevant to the average Indian state? And what is the correlation to national security and our deliberation today? My focus is on the cyber domain. Globalization and the current digitally driven economic trade patterns globally, regionally, within India are heavily dependent on cyber capabilities. Something as mundane and routine as an internet banking activity is totally dependent on the ability to receive the OTP and complete the transaction in the stipulated time. And to its credit, India has a very robust and efficient, I would say, cyber digital capability. However, many experts aver that the major security challenge that India would have to prepare for is by way of cyber attacks, big and small. We are aware that globally and regionally, there have been different forms of cyber attacks and aggression. Some have been reported, many are below the radar. As per the NCRB data in India, that is the National Crime Records Bureau, the total number of cyber crimes reported in 2010, roughly a decade ago, was 1,322. This increased to 44,546 in 2019. And this may well be the tip of the iceberg. By the way, I do want to acknowledge the contribution of my young researcher, Anhad, in putting all this data together. For anyone who wants more data on cyber, please contact me. I'll provide some more additional information. But the broader point I want to arrive at is that while India is investing in cyber capabilities at the central level, we are talking about a cyber fund, there is, to my mind, a strong case for individual states to invest in nurturing cyber skills, which in turn leads to education and the creation of infrastructure at the state level, wherein the private sector could also be prevailed upon to become stakeholders for the economic trade linkages in relation to today's e-commerce needs little reiteration. The multi-layered nature of this inclusive security paradigm is evident when we see this exploration leading to the need to recognize the centrality of education, which again is a state subject. India's younger demography, the human resource that must be equipped to engage with the challenges and opportunities of a 5G world has to become far more proficient in acquiring a scientific temperament than is the case now, and hence the need to value rigorous education in maths and the sciences at the primary level and all the way up to higher education. Again, as a security analyst, I would like to re-emphasize the point that education is a fundamental pillar of national security in as much as health is when it comes to the well-being of the citizen. Now, recent reports suggest that the average Indian student may be allowed to shed mathematics at class 10 and yet seek higher education in engineering and other science-related disciplines. I found this baffling. One hopes that this is not a case of policy cast in stone and that the experts would review this at the appropriate level. India's external and internal security have become interlinked. Again, this is a point that Mr. Bora pointed out. And they overlap in areas like state-sponsored terrorism and cyber crimes. The possibility of unmanned drones and underwater submersibles posing serious security challenges in the near future is a high probability. While the center in Delhi will continue to have what we might describe as the primary responsibility for national security, individual states can make a significant contribution in specific niches. Bringing security onto the state radar in an informed and holistic manner could be a first step. One hopes that the IIC can provide a platform to enable such deliberations to improve our collective understanding of the nature and the urgency of India's national security challenges. But let me say in conclusion that what is dismaying to me as an analyst is the ostrich act that India remains committed to when it comes to national security. I've said this in the past, I'm saying it again. This is a subject that is rarely deliberated upon in Parliament in an informed, objective, and non-partisan manner. The last Parliamentary Defence Committee report that was substantive, to my mind, the Khanduri report, has met the same fate as the 2000 Kargil review. Lip service. While the current COVID-induced resource constraints are no doubt to be acknowledged, there are many inadequacies that need to be redressed apropos the management of India's composite national security. Center-state relations and the responsibilities that devolve on these two entities is one strand. I hope that my remarks this afternoon will stimulate more deliberations on this vital subject. I thank you for your patience. Thank you, Bora sir, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Commodore Bhaskar. Now, we may have some questions. You will be happy to answer them.
Yes, sir, most likely.
Yeah, Kailash, are you online? Kailash, can you hear me? It seems there is some technical problem because I was told earlier that there would be a number of questions by some of our participants. देखो जरा फोन करके देखो क्या है इसमें से देख लो इज देयर एनी प्रॉब्लम
I'm looking at the chat box. Maybe Wasim or Tete can let us know if there are questions which are coming.
Yes, but I think we have lost our contact man.
Oh. You see, I'll just try and get Tete on WhatsApp.
I think we could perhaps, if you like, Uday, we could try to get on to these questions.
Yes, sir, most certainly. I'd be very glad. I hope our members would be able to add to our thinking and
whatever
we have said on
the wait, kya kehte? I think we could do that. From where do you start?
Wasim, if there are any questions, chat box, man, can you put them there? I can see the chat box. I think Srivastava.
Good afternoon, sir. Can I ask you, sir?
No, you slipped away at the right time. Now, you have a list of questions, Kalash? You have a list of questions with you?
Sir, I have a list, but this... Moderator panel has really not... Hello?
Hello, can you hear me? Kalash, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, sir. Are you able to hear me, sir?
Yeah, I think there is a technical problem. If somebody could read out the questions to us, then we could straight away get on to them. Can somebody read out the questions?
Wasim or Tete, can you put them there?
I will read out the questions.
Yeah, I think Tete, we will lose time. If you please start reading out the questions.
We have a question from Dr. Meenakshi Gopinath, and she says, in which ways has the pandemic compounded our national security challenges? In which?
Shall I respond, sir?
Yes, please.
In response to this question as to in which way has the pandemic compounded the national security challenge, my reading is that when the pandemic struck last year, if you recall, early 2020, there was a certain disruption to the larger communication transport network of the country. And one of the reasons that was advanced as to why Galwan had happened and the troops were perhaps surprised at that point was that the annual training program or pattern of the army in that area being disrupted because of the pandemic at that point in time. Now, that is just one which is very visible. But in the long term, answer in response to Dr. Gopinath's question, I would say that any country's security capability would be predicated on its exchequer, on the ability to allocate resources. And we have seen that over the last decade, even before the COVID pandemic, there was a certain pressure and defense allocations were being depressed, reduced. This has been aggravated because most estimates have indicated that India's GDP growth and the availability of resources both for development and for other sectors of national effort are going to be shrunk. And one area where I expect that there would be a reduction would be in the allocation of reasonably useful resources for capital allocation for the three armed forces. So the long-term implication is that many of the new initiatives, new platforms, also new areas. For instance, we spoke about cyber. There is a whole, I would say, spectrum of new technologies that the Indian military needs to get on top of, but would not be able to do so. So this is my short response, that the pandemic will have a long-term impact purely on the national military and related hard security capability. Tete?
The next question is from P.S. Das, and he says, there must be some reasons why India has not been able to formulate a coherent national security policy despite repeated stress placed at different times for its formulation. Can you highlight some of them?
You know, I have been grappling with this for a very long time. And my sort of short response, this needs, I think, a whole session by itself. And we need to get the views of people like Mr. Vora, for instance, who's been, as I said, Defense Secretary and PS to the PM, amongst other things. But my single sort of phrase is strategic culture. That India's strategic culture, when it comes to matters of national security, I'm afraid it is diffident, it is defensive, and it prefers to remain opaque, which is why I use the word opaque in my remarks. This is not the first time, and I am presuming that I am responding to Admiral P.S. Das. If that is the case, I think he has been a member of the earliest groups that were formed to look at this issue. And yet, while various drafts have done the rounds, and I'm sure people like him know the details, at the highest level, there has been a reluctance to place this in the public domain for much the same reason. And many of us have said this in the past, that the 1962 Henderson Brooks report still remains classified because India's strategic culture at the highest political level believes that it would compromise national security. So this is my short response, but I think it merits, perhaps Mr. Vora might like to come in, as to why we do not have a written document. Sir?
My rather brief response is, Uday, that in the 70 years and more of national governance, we have not been able to succeed in engendering even a limited number of political leaders across various parties who have serious interest in national security. Even those who are appointed to become responsible for defense or home may either not have any background and perhaps not even enough adequate interest. Likewise, correspondingly, I have been saying it for more than 30 years now, we have taken no concrete steps. The Kargil Committee report had accepted my recommendation that we need a cadre of functionaries who are specially trained and devoted only to security administration, who understand, if they're deployed in home, they understand what internal security is all about. And if they get deployed in defense, they understand what external security is all about. But we continue to revel and rejoice in ad hocism. And when the Deputy Prime Minister at that time and a group of ministers who considered the Kargil Committee report, they heard me on this issue for about 2 hours. And everybody in the government was present in that room. The group of ministers in their printed recommendation, written recommendation, accepted the need for at least a sub-cadre of security administrators, but this was not agreed to. Now, leave aside the question of budgetary allocations and so on and so forth, I think despite all the experiences that we have gone through, externally and internally, we haven't developed the stomach to deal frontally with national security issues. And as you yourself said, Uday, just now, we need very close union-state understandings, not merely cooperation, using the word cooperation, a very close collaborative functioning if you want to maintain national security. Not merely talk about it, but to enforce it, maintain it, and preserve the integrity and sovereignty of our country. So I think we have a long way to go in dealing with this issue. That is one reason why we don't have a national security policy. I have been lecturing on this issue and writing about it from around the late 1990s. Considerable period has passed. You yourself, Uday, you've been writing about it, speaking about it. Many of our other colleagues have written about it and spoken about it, both in the uniformed forces, in the civil services and the police, we have been individually or in small groups conscious of the seriousness of not having a laid down doctrine, and then from there to proceed to apportion our relative responsibilities as between the union and the states. It is not merely a question of making a one-line statement that we have good understandings. We have to materialize these understandings on the ground, on a real-time basis. You spoke just now about cyber crimes and the National Crime Bureau record showing they have grown 4,000 times. I am not in the picture. I am not aware of how far we have gone to prepare for counter-cyber organization, counter-cyber system on the ground, various affairs, in banking, in the defense services, in the entire economy at large, and in if you talk about the entire arena of science and technology, there could be sudden immediate subversion which would black you out, which put you out of business. That is a very, very alarming kind of scenario. So I would say we do need, and Admiral Das has been in the thick of it in the early years. And I remember being with him in several of these important meetings. But tragically, unfortunately, nothing has come out of it. Tete, what is the next question?
So there is a question from Prashant Tiwari, New Delhi. How important is the role of NSA in the comprehensive security architecture when the cabinet is defunct?
When the cabinet is?
Defunct.
I see. Udi, I think this is your pet area.
So that's very deft, but I will respond to this because we have discussed it many times. Let me share this, you know, within the confines of the IIC and its membership, that I was trying to do a small study on the role of the Indian NSA since inception. And this goes back to the time when Mr. Brijesh Mishra was appointed as India's first NSA. And I was encouraged to do this by the late Mr. K. Subramaniam, whom many, I think, in this audience, among our participants, would be more than aware of, and his own contribution. This was after Mr. Brijesh Mishra had demitted office. And there was a certain institutional kind of logic that it's the first time that India had an NSA, who was also the PS to the Prime Minister. So he was wearing two hats. And since India had acquired the nuclear capability, there was a sense that perhaps it would be useful to record some of this, since, again, the Indian institutional experience is very reticent about writing down you know, experiences and handing them down either to successors or to any kind of organization that could be the equivalent of the memory bank. So I made some attempts. I'm afraid I can't go into too much detail at this stage. But if the question from Mr. Tiwari is that what is the role of the NSA when the cabinet is defunct? Now, there are certain scenarios in many parts of the world where there is a nuclear capability, a WMD scenario, where there is what is called as the succession. That in the event of any exigency where the political leadership is not able to carry out or perform the functions assigned to it for discharging duties at the highest levels of national security challenges, then that succession list is laid down and all the people on that list know exactly what is to be done at which point. Now, in India, I say this in a slightly cautious way, to the best of my knowledge, we have not prepared such blueprints, nor have we carried out drills. Again, this is to the best of my knowledge, I stand corrected. But in the event that the entire system is defunct, to use Mr. Tiwari's turn of phrase, then the NSA has a very critical role to play. How that will be discharged, what would be done, I think is a matter of specifics. But as a parliamentary form of democracy goes, till such time as there is an alternative structure in place, the NSA would be the Sherpa for whatever be the nature of the transition, or the cabinet itself in whichever form comes back into circuit in terms of its own responsibilities at the political level. But I'll defer to Mr. Vora again and anyone else who might have some more to add on this. Vora, sir?
I won't like to go into details, but in 1997-98, recognizing that we are a federalism of our own kind, a prime ministerial cabinet system, not a presidential system, we had done a draft blueprint of what would happen if the parliament was in session and the entire cabinet was inside it, and our adversary bombed the parliament and we didn't have anybody left. There was no NSA at that time, if you recall. I, per chance, happened to be the last principal secretary to PM who was not the NSA. Brijesh Mishra was the first principal secretary and also NSA. And after that, J.N. Dixit and K. Narayanan, they were whole-time NSAs. So it's very good that we have a whole-time NSA in an institution which the NSA directs, supervises and manages. Now, I wouldn't know. I'm not in the picture. Maybe, as of today, there are some arrangements on the ground, but that is not a matter of public knowledge, nor is supposed to be. Tete, what is next?
This will be the last question, sir. We're running out of time. Yes. Ambassador Gitesh Sharma from Gurgaon asks, Indian diaspora abroad is seen as asset, but is there a negative dimension of some of their activities with consequences for national security?
Who are these people? He's talking of who? Diaspora?
The diaspora.
Now just read the first part of the question again.
Indian diaspora abroad is seen as asset, but is there a negative dimension of some of their activities with consequences for national security?
I think it's largely hypothetical. It could always be possible that some element in the Indian diaspora in some country or the other would be subverted, would be indulging in anti-national activities for whatever sake, for reasons of personal gain or otherwise. But you can't have an across-the-board formulation to say that the diaspora is not an asset. I would say principally, diaspora is an asset. And if there are exceptions, then they would need to be dealt with. Tete, are you suggesting that this is the end of the program?
So we should close. We've run out of time.
Right. Would you like to say anything?
No, sir, not at all. I mean, I think it's been very, I would say, good to have this kind of an interaction, and I think it's nice to have so many participants. But just as an aside, Tete, are there a large number of questions, or I'm just curious?
There are a lot of questions. We won't be able to take all of them.
What I would do is, Uday, that we could get all these questions from Tete, and I think we would go over them, and I attempt even to send some kind of responses to them.
So I think that's a very important suggestion.
Yeah.
So may I just add to this?
Not only deal with them, but I think we respond to them. Now, having said that, let me thank all our participants online, our viewers, and I would reiterate my concern that using the word national security is not merely indulging in some form of ideology or populism. It is one of those elements of our national governance which cannot bear with any compromise, nor can it bear with any internal confusion or compromise. On matters of national security, the entire nation has to be one. All political parties, organizations across the country have to be one. There has to be complete understanding in all political fora of what our national security interests are, how are we going to deal with them, how are we going to make sacrifices and contributions to enforce a particular element of national security management without too much rumor mongering or talking here and there? That's another facet of our national characteristic, that we talk a lot. We discuss serious security issues with inadequate responsibility. And that is why perhaps even in our parliament, national parliament, leave aside the state legislatures, we do not have that modicum of seriousness, of a recognition of our concerns, whether they are domestic or external or a mixture of both. I very much hope that some of the things that Commodore Bhaskar said today will provide enough basis to have further discussions, further debates, for being written upon or spoken about, and we carry this forward till hopefully we see a national security policy in position. Thank you very much, Uday, once again, and thank you all of you. Yes, please, you want to say something?
Yeah. May I?
Yes,
thank
please.
You, sir. I just want to add to what you have said, sir. Number one, to thank everyone. And for our participants who are unable to have their questions brought on board, I received a few messages on WhatsApp and some emails. So I'm very gratified that this subject has elicited so much interest. So my request to those of you who had questions, please send them to Tete, who in turn, I think, can collate them. And if you provide your numbers there, I promise you, I will at least give you an audio response to the extent that I'm able to, so that we can keep the subject alive, as Mr. Bora has suggested. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everybody, once again. Thank you.